This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us be glad and rejoice in it. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. For God has shown thee what is good. And what does the Lord require of thee but to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with our God? Good morning. We welcome you this morning to the Andrew Rankin Memorial Chapel. And we pray God's blessings upon you as we seek to worship our God in spirit and in truth. This morning, we are indeed blessed to hear a message from one of this nation's greatest leaders and preachers and a son of Howard University, the Reverend Dr. Jeremiah Wright, Jr. I count him as a friend and a brother. Pray for him as he comes to bring us a word from the Lord.
This week's scripture comes from Psalm 139, verses 1 through 6. And it reads, O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from far away. You search out my path, and my lying down are acquainted with all your ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, O Lord, you know it completely. You hem me in, behind and before, and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high that I cannot attain it. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
You know my name.
Let us prepare our hearts and minds for prayer. Let us be still before our God. Most gracious and loving God, before any human hands touched us, you already knew us. You're closer to us than even our own thoughts. And so we confess, O God, that our thoughts are not your thoughts. Our ways are not your ways. Help us to see your ways. Give us faith to trust your ways. To trust your ways when we're unable to make sense of what's going on within us and around us. To trust your ways. To trust you when we feel like giving up on ourselves and giving up on the people around us. Oh God, leave us not to ourselves, to our way of doing things. And when we become anxious and act out of our fears rather than our faith, when our own thoughts turn against us and harass us about our weaknesses and failures, when we find ourselves settling for less and accepting what is unacceptable. In these moments, hold us. Keep us. Rescue us from ourselves, from what we tell ourselves, and the ways in which we limit ourselves. Hold us, O God. Hold us until we think your good thoughts about us. Hold us until we stop being so hard on ourselves. Hold us until we believe in ourselves. Hold us until we remember what our forebears taught us, that you are able to make a way out of no way, that you will make a way for all that weighs heavy upon our hearts, that you will make a way even out of this awful and devastating pandemic. While you're holding us, make us to understand, O God, that you are also healing us. Hold us now. Hold us who feel alone. Hold us who are walking with grief. Hold us who are losing their hope for a better tomorrow. Hold especially our children, Lord. Protect not only their bodies, but protect their hearts. May they know love. May they feel love. May they experience real joy and real laughter. May they be free just to be children. And then, Lord, come and hold this nation, a divided nation, a nation at war with herself. A nation unwilling to face the truth about herself. A nation filled with people who are calling themselves by your name and yet are unwilling to humble themselves, to pray and to seek your face or to turn from ways that are hurting people. A nation in need of healing. Come now, Lord, and hold us in your love. Hold us until we learn how to love. In your name we pray. Amen.
Of sorrow, lost in this wide world alone. No hope have I for tomorrow. I've started to make heaven my home. Sometimes I'm tossed and driven, Lord. Sometimes a city called heaven, I started to make it my home. My mother has reached that pure glory. Still walking in sin, my brothers and sisters who are on me, because I'm trying to get in. Driven, Lord. Sometimes I don't know where to go. I heard of a city called heaven. Started to make it my home. Sometimes I'm tossed and driven, Lord. Sometimes I city called heaven, and I've started to make heaven my home.
Grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God our Father and from Jesus Christ, our Savior. To President Wayne Frederick, faculty, administration, students, alumni, and visitors to this virtual space, I greet you in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, and I greet you with Jesus' joy. To my beloved Dean, Dean Bernard Richardson, I thank you for this blessed opportunity to preach once again on the Martin Luther King weekend. This is our first time doing it virtually, and I pray God it will come out as you would have it come out. To our newcomers to the Howard Worship Experience, Rankin Chapel. I had a stroke 4 years ago, and as a result, my left side of my body is compromised, and my vocal cords do not touch as they should. The left cord has dropped over an inch so that it does not flutter with the right, and it makes like a sound like I have a cold. Please forgive me. I can't do anything about that. I hope you can understand me, and I hope God will use this message to bless your life. Shall we bow in prayer? Lord, speak to me that I may speak in living echoes of thy tone, as thou hast sought. So let me seek thy erring children lost and alone. Use me, Lord, use even me, just as thou wilt, and when and where. Until thy blessed face I see, thy peace, thy joy, thy glory share. Take this message, O God, and touch somebody's life, somebody's heart, somebody's mind. As we give you thanks for the Howard University community of faith, I give you thanks for the opportunity to be able to say a word on your behalf. In the name of Jesus, I offer this prayer. And the people of God together will say, Ashe and Amen. To the friends of the chapel, I thank you also for your kindness and your support. To B.P. Smith on the East Coast, and Anita Hackney all the way on the West Coast. Thank you, and God bless you. In the book of Jeremiah, the Jubilee edition of 2000, the 20th chapter, these words are written, O Lord, thou hast seduced me, and I was seduced. Thou wert stronger than I, and hast overcome me. I am in derision daily. Everyone mocks me. For since I spoke out, I raised my voice crying violence and destruction, because the word of the Lord has been a reproach unto me and a derision daily. And I said, I will not make mention of him, nor speak any more in his name. But he was in my heart as a burning fire, and within my bones. I tried to forbear, and I could not. Jeremiah 20, verses 7 through 9, Jubilee Bible Translation of 2000. Sometimes I feel like a motherless child. Sometimes I feel like a motherless child. Sometimes I feel like a motherless child, a long way from home. Sometimes I feel like I'm all alone. Sometimes I feel like I'm all alone. Sometimes I feel like I'm all alone, a long way from home. Sometimes I feel like I'm almost gone. Sometimes I feel like I'm almost gone. Sometimes I feel like I'm almost gone, a long, 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 long way from home. I would like for you to pray with me on this subject this Sunday. Sometimes. There are four sometimes I would like for you to consider today, biblically, historically, and contemporaneously. Sometimes I feel like a motherless child. Before my stroke, I would have tried to sing that for you. I no longer have a singing voice. Sometimes I feel like a motherless child. The spirituals created and sung by enslaved Africans on these shores capture a bundle of emotions, not only for those enslaved by the hatred of white supremacy and by European markets, they also capture the emotions of those who try to live as God would have them live. One of the verses of this motherless child spiritual says this is a song sung by and for true believers. True believers. Black and unknown African bards in the 17th, 18th, and 21st century feel isolated, alone, and sometimes homeless. When I was a graduate student here at Howard University, I was blessed to be a teaching assistant for Dr. John Lavelle. Dr. Lavelle, for the benefit of my millennials, wrote the definitive work on the Negro spirituals, Black Song, The Forge and the Flame, the story of how the Afro-American spirituals were hammered out. After spending 20 years collecting spirituals from all over the diaspora and on the continent of Africa, Dr. Lavelle was at the publishing stages as I was his teaching assistant. That was a blessing for me. My area of concentration while working on my first master's degree was the treatment of biblical passages in Negro spirituals. For those who may be interested, there's a copy of it in Morning Spingarn. It was amazing to me how a so-called illiterate people, a non-reading people, how they could capture such large amounts of scripture through the oral method of transmission, then transform those passages of scripture into haunting tunes, mysterious melodies, and meaningful messages that have lasted for over 200 years. The African spirituals function on many different levels. Sometimes they were code songs, signaling messages understood only by the in-group. Those code messages could be sung right in front of white masters and white mistresses who thought they were superior to blacks. And the white folks listening to those songs would have no clue what the Africans were saying or singing in that coded spiritual. Spirituals indeed cover a wide range of themes and purposes. Some were inspirational. Some were joyful noises in response to Psalm 100, which says, make a joyful noise unto the Lord. Some were songs of lament. And unfortunately, because of Dr. W.E.B. Du Bois labeling them as sorrow songs, the lament spirituals are the spirituals which are best known. Sometimes I feel like a motherless child is one of those lament spirituals. The other themes in and purposes of the spirituals, however, far outnumber those we know as sorrow songs. This particular spiritual that I have chosen, Sometimes I Feel Like a Mother's Child, I've chosen it to center our thoughts for the day, However, this spiritual functions on several different personal levels with me, and that is why I want to share with you on this Martin Luther King Sunday, when our nation's capital is still reeling from the blatant display of white privilege, white supremacy, and anti-black-white violence that we all saw on Epiphany Day, the 12th day of Christmas, January 6, 2021. The African composer of Motherless Child, or to be more exact, I should say the African composers, plural, of the spirituals. Spirituals are categorized in musicology as folk music, meaning there was more than one composer. The composers expressed in powerful words what it was like to be on a plantation in Barbados when home was in Benin, what it was like to be on a plantation in Alabama when their home was in Angola, what it was like to be on a plantation in Jamaica when their home was in Djibouti, what it was like to be on the sugar canes of North Carolina when their home was in Nigeria. They expressed what it was like to be making syrup and making rum in Louisiana when their home was in Luanda. They were, in fact, a long, long way from home. The harshness of the Middle Passage, the intentional breaking up of families, and the malicious separating of husband from wife, parent from child, and sister from brother to ensure that there could be no communication in Ga, Chui, Fon, Ewe, Kikuyu, or any of the Bantu family languages such as Ndebele, Zulu, and Xhosa. That separation created a feeling of isolation that is almost indescribable. Our cursory reading of the slave narratives, either in the Library of Congress Rare Book Room or in the Morland Spingarn collection, gives you a glimpse of the loneliness that produced such a line as, "Sometimes I feel so all alone, a long way from home." While wrestling with this text in the 20th chapter of Jeremiah, I wondered if Jeremiah ever felt motherless. The two books that he authored, the book of Jeremiah and the book of Lamentations, do not mention his mother. And while reading them, I wondered if that was a function of the patriarchal writers of our sacred text, or if indeed Jeremiah, once he left Anathoth, lost all contact with his mother. I don't know if he felt motherless, but I do know that he felt alone and that he felt sometimes almost gone. His being thrown into prison for speaking the word that God gave him surely left him feeling alone. His being attacked and vilified by the priestly class from Anathoth, his neighbors, his colleagues, and the prophets who were allegedly giving the word of God during the same period of time that he was, had to make him feel all alone. They were saying, "Peace, peace," when there was no peace. Jeremiah was saying, "Justice. Where there is no justice, there will be no peace." And that kind of preaching got him in trouble. Just like that kind of preaching gets you in trouble today. It got Jeremiah in trouble with the ministers of his day. And that kind of preaching gets me in trouble with the Paula Whites and the Creflo Dollars of today. Preaching Black Lives Matter gets you in trouble today, just like preaching justice got you in trouble in Jeremiah's day, and it gets you in trouble with both politicians and preachers. I don't know whether Jeremiah felt motherless or not, but today's text tells us in stark terms just how alone he felt and how abandoned he felt. The Jubilee Bible translates the Hebrew much more graphically than the King James translation or the New Revised Translation. Listen to those words again. Listen. O Lord, thou hast seduced me, and I was seduced. Jeremiah says that he was not deceived, as some translations try to clean it up. He was seduced in Hebrew. And the repetition of the word is what biblical scholars call it Hebrew dualism, to enforce the meaning of the verb. I like to think of it as a doubling up of a thought, or the doubling up of a verb in the manner of the Gullah-speaking Africans from the culture in the Low Country. To say, I done what you told me to do, repeats the verb done to put it in the superlative. As outdone, pun intended, as outdone as Jeremiah felt, I like to imagine him using the verb twice to emphasize the superlative of being raped. Now, before you accuse me like the Obamas accuse me of being over the top, Dr. Randall Bailey, Dr. Renita Weems, Dr. Jerome Ross, Dr. Vanessa Lovelace, Dr. Valerie Bridgman, all PhDs in Black Hebrew Bible, and other well-qualified biblical scholars say the same thing. The verb seduced in this passage is tantamount to rape. Jeremiah is accusing God of tricking him, wooing him, and then raping him. Jeremiah is saying that he was tricked by God. The verb overcome that he uses reinforces the verb used for seduction. Look what he's saying. God talked him into a helpless position and then stuck it to him, literally. Now, for those in our virtual congregation who are not Bible scholars or Bible readers, for that matter, if you go back to Jeremiah, the first chapter, and listen to the smooth talk that eases Jeremiah into a position of being comfortable, you'll see what I'm saying. Milton Brunson and the Thompson Community Singers of Chicago would put it this way. Jeremiah was feeling, quote, safe in his arms, unquote. Jeremiah 1 says, when the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah, assuring him that God had set him apart before he was born and had appointed him as a prophet, Jeremiah protested, saying he was too young and that he did not have the ability to speak well. Chapter 1, verse 7 says, quote, but the Lord said to me, do not say, I am too young. You must go to everyone I send you to and say whatever I command you, end quote. Now, listen to verse 8 and hear God smooth talking. Quote, do not be afraid, for I am with you, and I will rescue you, declares the Lord. Quote, then to seal the deal, God kisses him. Look at verse 9. Verse 9 says, then the Lord reached out his hand and touched my mouth and said to me, I put my words in your mouth. God sweet talked him into feeling comfortable And then God left him out there on a limb all on his own, or so it seemed to Jeremiah. Sometimes I feel like I'm all alone. Jeremiah ended up in a cistern. Jeremiah ended up in prison. And Jeremiah ended up being the laughingstock of the nation. His colleagues in ministry, the priestly class of Anathoth and Jerusalem, and from his hometown to his nation's capital, Teddy Pendergrass would say right here in the text, "The whole town laughing at me. Silly fool, how'd you?" You know this passage resonated with me, don't you? Look at it. Quote, "I am in derision daily," quote, says Jeremiah the prophet. "And I am in derision daily," says Jeremiah Wright Jr. "Everyone mocks me," is what this prophet from the 6th century B.C. has to say in terms of what God has done to him. Everyone is mocking him. Now please let me take a moment of personal privilege right here before diving deeper into this text. As many of you in the Howard community know, my daddy let me know the day he was placed in home hospice care. The doctors told him he had 4 months to live, and he lived 4 months and 4 days after the day they gave him that notification. I was blessed to be able to spend every other week with him for 3 of those months. My sister and I alternated. She'd take 1 week, then I would take 1 week. And I was blessed to spend every week the last month of his life by his bedside. God blessed me in a powerful way. As I told the members of my congregation when I was a pastor, God allowed me to spend time with the man I loved so dearly, the man who had taught me how to live. And God let me be with him during his final days so that that man could teach me how to die. During that period of time while I was at his bedside in Philadelphia every day, the black-owned radio station that had been playing our worship services, Trinity's, over their station in Philadelphia every Monday through Friday for 10 years, that station was bought out by a racist white Christian station, the same kind of station like Rush Limbaugh's station that would have backed the stupidity we saw when the Trump supporters took over the Capitol with a Confederate flag in their typical white, arrogant fashion on January 6th. Please don't forget the Christian evangelist, Paul White, rambling on, blah, 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 rattling on like a stuck rattlesnake, which she is, as she called on the angels from Africa to give her victory and give President 45 victory. How did you do it? How could you do it? I taste victory. I predict victory. I see victory. I see victory. My parents would listen to us every morning, Monday through Friday, on that black-owned station. And as a result, they heard the news about the white racist Christian station purchasing their station, a station they had come to love and listen to for over a decade. Self-advertising right here. You can read all about this in my memoirs. I've written them. They're being edited as we worship today. My father said to me in the last month of his life, "You know that white station ain't gonna let you be on their station any longer, don't you?" I said, "Yes, Daddy, I know that." He said, "Them white folk don't wanna hear nothing you preaching. Do you realize that?" I said, "Yes, Daddy, I realize that." The room fell into a deep silence for about 3 minutes, with neither one of us saying anything. Then he said to me, words I'll take to my grave with me. But don't you stop preaching, boy. You ain't telling nothing but what God loves, which is the truth. Don't stop preaching. White folk don't want to hear about their racism, but don't you stop preaching. White folks don't want to hear about America's terrorism, but don't you stop preaching. White folks don't want to hear about white privilege, but don't you stop preaching. White folks don't want to hear the truth, but you keep on preaching truth just as God gives it to you. I thanked my father, and I assured him that what I had been doing at Trinity for 30 years at that point, in 2000, I would continue to do until retirement, until my death. In case you did not know, it was from sermons that I had preached in 2001 and 2005 when Barack wasn't even a senator. It was from those sermons that the racist media took sound bites, trying to scare white folks and scare nervous Negroes away from Obama as he was running to become the commander-in-chief of these yet-to-be United States of America. I wasn't trying to hurt Obama. As one of the Howard University worshipers right here in Crampton Auditorium said to me in 2008, why don't you stop trying to hurt Obama? I wasn't trying to hurt Obama. The media was trying to hurt him. Martin also said, now run, tell that. But from the time during the first week in March that ABC and Fox News started running sound bites of my sermons, I was derided daily. White folks mocked me. Racists mocked me. Conservative whites mocked me. Conservative Christians mocked me. So-called progressive Christians mocked me. Conservative blacks, and whom Ben Chavis calls nervous Negroes, mocked me. I became the laughingstock of the nation. The whole town laughing at me. From the nation's capital and James Clyburn, all the way out to Chicago and my member, Cleo Staples. Back to the text. I want you to get nervous because I'm calling names. Back to the text. Jeremiah says, for since I spoke out telling the truth, since I raised my voice crying violence and destruction because of the word of the Lord and the word the Lord gave me, is what caused the religious community and the political community to reproach me. And once again he says, I became a derision daily. 13 years after Mr. Obama was elected, I still get mocked, derided, or as a song in our tradition says, I get lied on, cheated, talked about, mistreated. And 13 years later, both Michelle and Barack Obama felt it necessary to convince their white supporters who selected them before we elected them that they had no idea what I was preaching after having been members for 20 years. In both of their books, they deride me and mock me. Worse yet, they attack the black church and the black religious tradition. Jeremiah, the prophet, said, I got so sick of it that I'm sad I'm not going to mention his name anymore. I'm not going to say anything that has the word Yahweh in it. I refuse to say Jehovah. I refuse to say Yeshua. Sometimes I'm up. Sometimes I'm down. Sometimes I'm level to the ground. At the outside of this message, I said there were four sometimes. The last sometimes I want you to consider, however, is this. The first one was, sometimes I feel like a motherless child. The second one was, sometimes I feel like I'm all alone. The third one was, sometimes I feel like I'm almost gone. There's another sometimes, however. It comes from a different spiritual. And that sometimes comes from the answer that the same Africans who wrote this spiritual, the answer they gave to Jeremiah's most painful question. If you'll remember, Jeremiah raised another question. When he saw the suffering of his own people, when he felt the pain from his own daily division, when he experienced the stings of constant mocking, Jeremiah asked the question, is there no balm in Gilead? Is there no physician there? Why then aren't my people healed? Dr. King looked at the enslaved Africans' response to Jeremiah's question, and he rephrased their response this way. He said that Jeremiah ended his deep, painful, and probing question with a question mark. Is there no balm in Gilead? Question mark. Is there no physician there? Question mark. The enslaved Africans, a long, long way from home, knew there was a response to Jeremiah's question. And King says they took his question mark and straightened it out. They straightened it out into an exclamation point, where Jeremiah the prophet had asked, is there no balm in Gilead? Enslaved Africans sang and shouted, yes, there is a balm in Gilead. There is a balm in Gilead to make the wounded whole. There is a physician who heals the wounds of those dragged from their homes in West Africa, dragged from their homes in Central Africa, dragged from their homes from as far away as Mozambique and Zimbabwe in South Africa. There's a physician whom we call Dr. Jesus. He is a doctor who's never lost a patient. There's a physician who heals the sin-sick soul. In this second spiritual they created, the verse says, sometimes, here's the fourth sometimes. And the final point on this Dr. King Sunday, sometimes I feel discouraged and think my work's in vain. That is Jeremiah's testimony, as he says in response to his daily division, in response to the daily mocking, and in his response to his legacy of being a prophet who is, quote, so-called on the wrong side of history. Sometimes it gets discouraging. Sometimes you're made to feel as though your work has been in vain. 36 years of my pastoring, trashed not only by nervous Negroes, trashed not only by those who believe more in political respectability and the truth of God's word, trashed by nervous Negroes, trashed by Uncle Toms, trashed by white women like Clarence Thomas's wife, who supported the racist rioters on January 6th. Trashed by radio stations who don't want truth preached over their airwaves. Trashed by the ex-First Lady. Trashed by the ex-Commander-in-Chief. Sometimes it feels like it's all in vain. Sometimes it feels like this has all been in vain. Almost everybody in our virtual audience at Howard knows that Father Mike Flager has been a friend of mine for 42 years, pastor of the St. Sabina Community of Faith in Chicago for over 40 years. 40 years Mike spent on behalf of the black community, 40 years of his standing up when black preachers would not stand up. 40 years of a dedicated life that is responsible for waging war against gun violence in one of the most dangerous neighborhoods in the city of Chicago. 40 years trashed by a coon trying to blackmail my friend. His case will quickly be thrown out, But to Father Mike, it feels like all people will remember in terms of his legacy. He says like Jeremiah, and he says like me, this is what I'll be remembered for. Jeremiah died a long way from home. He was stoned to death by his associates, thrown under a bus of stones by fellow preachers, prophets, and priests. He was buried under a pile of rocks, hurled not to hurt him but to kill him, shut him up permanently in Egypt. He died in Egypt, a long, long way from Anatoth in Jerusalem. Is this how people will remember me? Sometimes I feel discouraged, and I think my work's in vain. However, if you look at what Jeremiah says, and look at what the Africans sang, you'll see God at work in an awesome way. Jeremiah said, I was so alone, I was so down, I said, I will not make mention of him nor speak anymore in his name, but he was in my heart as a burning fire. Alan Buzak says it's a fire that cannot be put out. He was within my bones. I tried not to say anything else, but I could not. In other words, I said I wasn't going to tell nobody, but he was like fire shut up in my bones. Dr. Buzak says of me, I got fire shut up in my bones, a fire that cannot be quenched. My assistant, Charles Lofton, would say, fire. I got fire in my bones. That is my testimony, and that is what the enslaved Africans sang. Sometimes I feel discouraged and think my work's in vain, but then the Holy Spirit revives my soul again. There is a balm in Gilead. We call him Jesus because he's a doctor. He heals the hurt put on by humanity, and he heals the wounded with only a touch. Jesus. Jesus. Jesus, say it with me. Jesus. The more I say it, the better I feel. And the better I feel, the more I say it. Jesus. 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 How did he revive my soul, you ask? I'm glad you ask. By calling into my remembrance, like he said he would through the Holy Spirit. In the book of John, Jesus said the Holy Spirit would bring to my remembrance. And look at the Spirit bringing me into remembrance of how good God is and how sweet Jesus is. He's sweet, I know. He reminded me of three things. First of all, he reminded me of this. Jeremiah Wright, this ain't about you. This fight for justice, peace, love, and equity is about generations of Africans who came before you, the generation of Africans who are fighting behind you, and the generations of Africans yet unborn. Secondly, the Holy Spirit reminded me, this is a long-distance race. You're just running one lap. Somebody passed you the baton. Stay in your lane, run your lap, and pass the baton on to the next generation. Finally, the Holy Spirit reminded me to run this race with patience and remember, the battle is not yours, it's mine, says the Lord, and you are not alone. Don't be like Elijah and think you're the only one. Elijah told God, I'm the only one out here. God told Elijah, I got at least 7,000 more, just like you, you know. Let me say that again, just like you, you know. 70,000 or 700,000 who have not bowed their knee to racism, who have not bowed their knee to Uncle Tomism, who have not bowed their knees to white supremacy, who have not bowed their knees to white terrorism, who have not bowed their knees to white privilege, who have not bowed their knees to American exceptionalism, who have not bowed their knees to sexism, to heterosexism, to militarism, to capitalism, to classism, or colorism. Jeremiah, if you know, say you know. Our community, say you know. The Holy Spirit reminds me, look at who I've got, Jeremiah. I got Chadwick Boseman, H-U, you know. Toni Morrison, H-U, you know. Ta-Nehisi Coates, H-U, you know. Sterling Brown, H-U, you know. Arthur Davis, H-U, you know. Ivan Taylor, H-U, you know. Olive Taylor, H-U, you know. Martha Cobb, H-U, you know. Donny Hathaway, H-U, you know. Roberta Flack, H-U, you know. Bernice Reagan Johnson, Sweet Honey in the Rock, H-U, you know. Alain Locke, H-U, you know. William Leo Hansberry, H-U, you know. John Lavelle, H-U, you know. Richard Smallwood, H-U, you know. Willie Wilson, H-U, you know. Cornell Moore, H-U, you know. Vernon Jordan, H-U, you know. Kane Hope Felder, H-U, you know. Kenyatta Gilbert, H-U, you know. Yolanda Pierce, H-U, you know. Howard Thurman, H-U, you know. Greg Carr, H-U, you know. Kwame Ture, H-U, you know. Both Dr. Neighbor and Dr. James Cheek, H-U, you know. Dr. Dana Williams, H-U, you know. Haile Garima, H-U, you know. Felicia Rashad, H-U, you know. Debbie Allen, H-U, you know. Marshall Grigsby, H-U, you know. Thurgood Marshall, H-U, you know. Spotswood Robinson, H-U, you know. Evans Crawford, H-U, you know. Bernard Richardson, H-U, you know. Jesse Norman, H-U, you know. Lawrence Jones, H-U, you know. Gay Byron, H-U, you know. Ron Walters, H-U, you know. Friends of the Chapel, B. Smith. Friends of the Chapel, Anita Hackney, H-U, you know. Guess what? I got three generations of Wrights right here. Jeremiah Wright Jr., H-U, you know. My daughter, Jamila Nandi Wright, H-U, you know. My granddaughter, Jasmine Lynn Hall, H-U, you know. My grandson, Jeremiah Antonio Wright Hall, Haynes, H-U, you know. Do it, Holy Spirit, revive us again. In hip-hop language, God would say, Jeremiah, I ain't even through. Doug Wilder, Governor of the State of Virginia, H-U, you know. Patricia Harris, Secretary of Health, Education, and Welfare, H-U, you know. And guess what? No, guess who? Kamala Harris, H-U, you know. Vice President Kamala Harris, H-U, you know. First Woman Vice President of the New United States, H-U, you know. First African-American Vice President of the New United States, H-U, you know. First AKA Vice President of the United States of America, H-U, you know. First Howard University Alumnus Vice President of the United States of America, H-U, you know. But then, even after I feel discouraged and think my work's in vain, then the Holy Spirit revives my soul again. There is a balm in Gilead. Pat Harris, Secretary of Health, Education, and Warfare. Thurgood Marshall, H-U, you know. Spotswood Robinson, Brown versus Board of Education. Douglas Wilder. Let us pray. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you for reminding us that you said it is not by power, the power of American military, the power of Russian military, the power of North Korean military, the power of the Proud Boys military. It is not by might, taking over a capital, taking over textbooks, taking over truth, but by my Spirit, says the Lord. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for reviving us. when we feel discouraged and think our work's in vain. May this message bless some life today. And the people of God together will say, Ashe and Amen.
a timely message. Though the physical doors of the chapel are closed, the chapel remains open and vibrant as we continue to support the entire Howard University community. And we need your financial contributions. In order to support the ministry of the chapel, please visit our website, chapel.howard.edu. There you will find a give link. And during this time of uncertainty, never forget the power of prayer. You may submit prayer requests via the chapel website as well. In celebration of the holiday honoring the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., the Office of the Dean of the Chapel will host Service and Justice Day tomorrow. This service project is coordinated in support of Howard alumna and Vice President-elect Kamala Harris and the Presidential Inauguration Committee for the National Day of Service. To participate in this service day, please visit the chapel website. We are so excited to bring back the Communal Conversation series this semester. Join us for our first installment on Monday, January 25th at our new time, 8 p.m. In Communal Conversations, we will discuss new year, new what? Students will be able to work towards newness and the resurgence of COVID-19, as well as white supremacy violence. We'll go live on YouTube, Facebook, and Twitter. We cannot wait to see you there. To stay updated on all things chapel, follow us on social media, Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook with the handle @HowardUChapel. Take a moment now and subscribe to our YouTube page and like us on Facebook. Lastly, wherever you're worshiping with us, share your experience with the hashtag SundaysAreForChapel. We now welcome Dean Richardson, who will lead us in our benediction.
Prepare your hearts and minds to receive the benediction. We thank you, O God, for what eyes have seen, our ears have heard, and our hearts have felt. We thank you for Dr. Jeremiah Wright. And now I said to the one who stood at the gate, give me a light that I may go out into the darkness and into the unknown. And he replied to me, go out into the darkness, go out into the unknown. But put your hand in the hand of God, and God shall be for you better than light and much safer than a known way. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and give you peace, both now and forevermore. Amen.